Good evening, I'm Peggy Scott Laborde, and welcome to Steppin Out, spotlighting the New Orleans area's arts and entertainment scene. Seated at our table tonight, Ian McNulty, restaurant writer for the New Orleans Advocate. Hey, Ian, good
Hi, Peggy. See you.
Hello.
Great to be here.
Hi.
Thank you.
Great to have you. Keith Spera, music writer for the Times-Picayune and NOCCA.com, and he also writes the paternity test column about his dear children. Great to see you.
Likewise.
And his amazing wife.
Yes.
Okay.
She has
we're
a guest starring role.
There,
yes.
Kiddo.
Amazing.
Okay. All
right. Amazing woman. Yes.
And we have Alan Smason, editor of the online Crescent City Jewish News. Hello, Alan.
Hey there.
And making his Steppin' Out debut, Mark Cortale, producer of the Broadway at NOCCA series. Good to see you, Mark.
Hey, Peggy. Thanks.
And I know you wear many
me.
Hats, and we're glad you're wearing that particular one. Hey. And Poppy Tooker will return after the holidays. We also want to thank our friends Ricardo Pustanio and Jay Richard. We've been enjoying this so much. They build the crew of Mid-City Parade, but they have let us in our studio host a tribute to Mr. Bingle over these past few weeks, and so many, many thanks. It's actually provided a whole lot of joy. But now we move on to Mr. Ian.
Yeah, well, wanted to bring something up on the food front, a trend that we covered a little earlier in the New Orleans Advocate this year, but I thought that would be good to bring up again here at the end of the year when, I mean, we have lots of people in town, maybe have a little time off. You want to go out and do something kind of New Orleans-y, get a little snack. We're talking beignets. There has been a little... I dare say boom in beignets lately. I've been seeing them all over town at everything from neighborhood restaurants that are adding them to their menus to fine dining restaurants that are doing like upscale renditions
crab
of the beignets.
And,
savory ones, sweet ones, dessert versions, creative versions, traditional versions. But I wanted to call out two places that are both new, but are both taking the whole beignet experience in two different directions. And one will be very familiar to people, just its name, the Morning Call Coffee Stand, of course, dating back to 1870. Opened in City Park just about a year ago.
Yeah.
Kind of hard to
yeah.
believe. When you look at this place, it looks like it's been there forever.
It does.
It's in the old casino building. I love this picture. This is from our great photographer, John McCusker. I just love this. There's a couple kissing there. I mean, this could be decades ago. This could be in a Peggy Scott Laborde documentary. the beignets that were, you know? It really could. But this is the scene in there all the time. They still make the beignets the old-fashioned way there. The scene is very... It's nostalgic, but it's vibrant at the same time. This place is open 24/7, right there along the lagoons of City Park. It's really kind of an incredible thing. A foggy night, you see the neon glowing. Very often in the evenings, they'll have bands that will set up and play there. And as always, I mean, the place just sort of attracts characters. I mean, the staff are always very entertaining. The family that runs it, very interesting. And I always have a blast when I go there. It's a great way to kind of reconvene with like an old feeling part of New Orleans that is also very fresh and new because they've branched out. They've come back to the city. They're thrilled to be there. It's one of those, that sort of energy of the new Orleans rooted in the past that you can feel. That it, you know, for a plate of beignets and a cup of coffee, they're not asking too much for that experience.
And the kids that are there now too, after prom night, they'll come over there. It's amazing. It really is.
Exactly. 24 hours a day. So you can see tourists during the day or night people in the wee hours. It's all there. Now, taking a whole different tact on the beignet experience is this new place called New Orleans Coffee and Beignet Company. Now, this is an offshoot of a restaurant group that you're probably familiar with, New Orleans Hamburger and Seafood Company. Been around for a long time. They started a coffee and beignet parlor in their uptown location a few years back. It was such a hit, they decided, well, let's make a whole cafe concept out of it. So this is the new one that just opened in December in Metairie. This used to be a Burger King location. Totally redesigned, except they kept the drive-through, so you can get drive-through beignets, and they designed a new chocolate beignet. That's pretty interesting. They're trying to get people to use...
Oh, what a good idea.
Yeah, they're trying to get people to use the beignet parlor the same way you'd use a Starbucks or a PJ's, you know, the place to go for your everyday coffee, but they just happen to serve a lot more traditional and somewhat updated New Orleans food. So pretty interesting place, and they have big plans for that concept. They plan to open a few more even in the year ahead and after that.
Well, you know, it's funny because growing up, we didn't call them beignets. We called them donuts.
Yeah.
And that's still kind of a local thing. I mean, now I think we're calling them beignets more, but it used to be just donuts, which, and now, of course, also, there's so many donuts, like Blue Dot and all these others, so you almost need to say beignet to distinguish them.
That's right. right. Well, the beignet, let's face it, it's one of those emblems of the city. You know, they turn up on Mardi Gras beads, on greeting cards. Everyone wants to come to town and have a beignet. Well, now for us locals, if this boom keeps going, there's a lot more places to take that emblem and eat it.
All right. Absolutely. And we turn to Keith. And Keith, we've been, you know, waiting with bated breath here in terms of you get to listen to a lot of CDs.
Yes.
Being the music writer for NOLA.com and Times-Picayune. But you had a favorite this year, huh?
I did. And you're right. There was the typical avalanche of good music came out of this town this year. I mean, if you still count, you know, Aaron Neville lives in New York now, but we still count him as a New Orleanian. He started off the year with a great doo-wop CD called My True Story. Trombone Shorty put out his third national CD, which was solid. A guy named Gregory Agee, the local clarinet player, put out a real listenable great jazz CD. But yes, my favorite local CD of the year was Preservation Hall's That's It. And kind of a historical CD, in fact, because in the history of Preservation Hall, they have never put out an album of all original material before. Mm-hmm. They've always done traditional songs, remakes of old songs, old traditional New Orleans standards. But on this CD, every single song on it was written by a current member of the band.
Hmm.
And it's done in the old style. I mean, it's very much traditional jazz. You're not going to, you know, they're not rapping on it or doing anything crazy. But there's a freshness to it that you get with playing songs for the first time on record, basically, that you don't get playing the standard sometimes.
Well, clearly, Benji Jaffe has a lot of vision. And a few years back with the Del McCrory collaboration, that
sure.
was brilliant, too.
Well, he has been very, very smart and aggressive about rebranding Preservation Hall, or at least freshening up the brand. I mean, he's taken the band, you know, they play at Bonnaroo, they play at Voodoo, they got up on stage with Billy Joel at Jazz Fest. They're up on stage, with Mumford & Sons, you know, when they played in town recently. So he's very much into the idea of introducing Preservation Hall to a younger audience. And one of the ways you do that is you come up with new songs. You know, I mean, God bless St. James Infirmary, but it's been covered a whole heck of a lot, you know. You don't need necessarily another recorded version of the song. I mean, those songs are great. They're part of the New Orleans repertoire. They'll always be in the repertoire. But to come up with a collection of new songs that very much stands alongside those classics is is a remarkable thing. And the record's gotten really good attention. It was put out by a division of Sony, so it's gotten a lot of attention nationwide, a lot of good press for the band. So it really brought them a lot of positive attention, and well-deserved, absolutely.
I am excited about, and this is fairly recent, the Rounder releases of with Booker and the new Alan Toussaint, too.
Absolutely.
Huh? Grammy nominations coming up, too. And...
Sure, yeah, Alan, you can't, one of the great songbooks of New Orleans music. His collection is great. And James Booker, one of the kind of lost geniuses. I mean, there's a documentary that came out about Booker,
back,
and it's an incredible story. I mean, here's a guy that was freakishly talented, could play any style of piano music, often all at once, but, you know, had all kinds of personal demons that really kind of got in the way of him becoming a star. Yet, he tutored a young kid named Harry Connick Jr. and basically helped Harry become a star. You know, those lessons that he imparted. So,
George Buck. We just lost George Buck, this incredible, longtime traditional jazz record producer. Mm-hmm. Let's reflect a little bit on his career.
You know, George, fascinating guy. Grew up in New Jersey. Became a fan of traditional New Orleans jazz at a very early age. Started making records with guys that would come up to that part of the country. Eventually moved down to New Orleans in the late 80s. Bought a building on Lower Decatur Street. Installed the Palm Court Jazz Cafe on the ground floor. His wife, Nina, basically spearheads that whole effort there. And meanwhile, he founded and acquired 9 different labels that put out jazz music. And the top 2 floors of that building are just this incredible repository of recorded music that he sends out to jazz fans all over the world. He's got a mailing list, you know, with thousands and thousands of names on it, and is constantly sending out this music that no one else would have probably recorded nor kept in circulation.
A while back, Lars Ettergren, the talented band leader and pianist, was starting to help George with the GHB record label, and we're certainly hoping all that will continue on.
Absolutely.
And then Larry McKinley, goodness, last few weeks, huh?
Literally, if you've ever gone to the New Orleans Jazz Fest, you've heard Larry McKinley's voice.
That's right.
It is the voice coming out of those ice chests at the gate that is telling you, you know, don't park here, get your tickets there, have a nice day. You know, he was the recorded voice. But more more than that, I mean, his history with New Orleans goes back decades. I mean, he was a radio personality in the 50s, in the 60s.
Concert promoter?
In the 60s, co-founded Minute Records, which hired a young, unknown Alan Toussaint as their music director. And with Alan at the helm, they did great singles by Ernie Cato, Mother-in-Law, came out on Minute Records, Jesse Hill, Ooh Poo Poo Doo, Benny Spellman, Lipstick Traces, Irma Thomas, Ruler My Heart. Mm-hmm. These are all records that came out on Larry's label Minute in the 60s. And then, of course, he went on to do other things.
He was partnered with my uncle originally with Minute Records with Joe Banishek, too.
That's right.
My uncle Irving Smith sold that out. He didn't want to handle that part of the business anymore.
Mm. Yeah. So, yeah, Larry, great, you know, incredible story with Larry.
Before we move on, we're sort of in the half and final season of Treme. Mm-hmm. What impact, it seems like that is an incredible showcase for a lot of local performers. What impact do you think that that series has had in terms of the music scene?
Well, it certainly put a lot of money in the pockets of musicians. I mean, every time they licensed a song by a New Orleans guy or used a performance, I mean, that was a paycheck for several thousand dollars that went in that person's pocket. But also, I think it gave people a sense of the community of New Orleans music and how it's interrelated and how it really is a living, breathing community. So anyone that watches that show, I'd say more than really any other show or movie that I've ever seen, really gave you a realistic sense of what that community of musicians is like and really that it is a community. But yeah, great exposure, incredible. And like I said, those guys did a good job of presenting it in an authentic manner.
All right, Keith, thank you very much. My pleasure. Speaking of music, a different kind of music, some Broadway tunes here. Mr. Mark Cortale, and you have moved to New Orleans from
New
York.
Yes, I have.
This is big.
I'm really excited. What a thrill to be here. I moved at the beginning of October, and I'm living in the French Quarter. And, you know, I've been working here on and off for the past 10 years, and it's a long time coming, but I'm actually here now. Very excited.
There has been this amazing series, this Broadway series at NOCCA, and you're the guy who put this together between Patti LuPone and Megan Hilton. You've got two more coming up here. Tell us about how that came to be.
Well, Seth Rudetsky and I, we started the series in Provincetown in Massachusetts on Cape Cod in the summer of 2011. And Jeff Roberson, who is one
AKA
of my clients, Varla Jean Merman, said from the get-go, oh, this would be such a hit in New Orleans, you should bring it down. And, I thought, wow, that would be incredible to have a place outside of this summer, beach resort to do it. And I connected with Richard Reed from NOCCA, who was on vacation in Provincetown, and pitched the series to him, and he was very responsive. And, that was in the summer of 2012. I think we spoke that August, and by January of this past year, we launched with Patti LuPone. It's hard to believe it hasn't even been a year, and we've had so many fantastic concerts.
Well, let's talk about who's coming up first in early January.
Alice Ripley, Tony winner for Next to Normal. I fell in love with Alice seeing her in Sideshow with Emily Skinner back in 1998. I'm actually a twin, and I'm not sure if you know Sideshow, but it's about the conjoined twins, the Hilton sisters. And one of the greatest performances I've ever seen on Broadway, and certainly Next to Normal, Alice was just sensational. And she is coming on January 6th with her pianist Jessica Means, and she's doing a show that she just premiered at 54 Below in New York.
The place.
Uh-huh. And she's gonna be singing with piano, but also singing, accompanying herself on guitar. She's, really an extraordinary musician, and I think it's gonna be great. And she'll be singing songs from all of the shows that she originated, which separate from Next to Normal and Sideshow, it's Rocky Horror Picture Show and Sunset Boulevard, and I'm blanking on the others.
So any Broadway babies, this is the show to see.
This is the one. And also, speaking of Broadway babies, on January 27th, the Broadway baby, Sutton Foster, two-time Tony winner for Thoroughly Modern Millie, and also Anything Goes, is coming on January 27th. She was supposed to join us in April, but the big news is that she was cast as the title role in the musical Violet at the Roundabout Theater, which is starting up in, I think, May.
Mm.
So we're thrilled to have both these phenomenal ladies, and we are, in fact, for Broadway at NOCCA, we're offering a holiday pass. So for only $50, you can get tickets to both shows, kind of a two for one, to thank all of our loyal patrons. So it's on our website, and it'll be good through January 5th.
Okay, once again, the website?
BroadwayNOLA.com.
Okay, and you wanted to mention Golden Girls is coming up, too.
Oh, sure, Golden Girls, which opens tonight, and runs until January 12th at Mid-City Theater, with Varla Jean Merman and Ricky Graham and Brooklyn Schaefer and a wonderful, wonderful company. So I think it's gonna be a real hoot.
I'm sure it will be. Ricky Graham and Varla Jean are the chameleons of chameleons, aren't they?
They sure so are. Versatile. I can't recognize them anymore.
Well, maybe with your sweet talking, we can get Mr. Jeff Roberson, a.k.a. Varla Jean, on.
Sure, absolutely.
That'd be a lot of fun. Okay, thank you. And we turn to Alan.
Well,
yes, sir.
We're doing a little bit of a recap because obviously we're coming to the end of the year, and I wanted to sort of go over some of the best of the best, or at least in my estimation. I think that a lot of people agree that we had some wonderful musicals this year. I wanted to start off talking about the first one that we're going to talk about, I guess, is the more recent of all of them, is that's Hair, that was done over at Le Petit Theater.
So good.
Welcome back, again, you know, that grand lady of the theater, Le Petit. We actually had a musical come back for the first time, and we're going to have later on Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. But there was Hair in all its splendor, great choreography and great singing and, you know, a true ensemble cast, wonderful. And then, of course, I wanted to go back to last summer, if you will. We had Monty Python's Spamalot, which was over at Rivertown Repertory Theater, Rivertown Theaters for the Performing Arts. It's a bad habit to break. They used to be known as that, but Rivertown Theaters for the Performing Arts, and again, a cast that was splendid, wonderful. Also, you'll see a couple of repeats because Rivertown gets more than just one mention in this musical offering. Next to Normal, you mentioned that just again. Southern Repertory did a wonderful version of this starring Leslie Castaigne. The Ripley role. We'll mention that Southern Repertory also did some wonderful productions in drama and some comedies. We also wanted to mention Annie at Rivertown. There's Laura Grice and the girls, and they, you know, were just completing their run, so we appreciated all that they did to make audiences happy. Bree was the little Annie. She was just wonderful, Bree Hollis, and again, I would mention that those of you who saw her knew how great a job she did. And again, one of my favorites, 42nd Street. They just pulled all the stops out on this at Rivertown, and I just think that they did a splendid job. If anybody got a chance to see how remarkable the singing, the dancing was, you will know why we love that one. Also, I wanted to mention, you know, there they are, Hair, Monty Python, Spamalot, Next to Normal, Annie, and 42nd Street. I wanted to also mention some of the national tours that came here. Now, these, of course, not all of them, but I thought a shout-out should be made to Wicked, was it the Mahalia Jackson, as irreverent as ever, the Book of Mormon at the Sanger Theater. It may have put a few people off of their theater game, but, you know, it was a very funny, very, very irreverent presentation. And those of you who, of course, love the music of the Four Seasons, Jersey Boys at the Mahalia Jackson was also quite notable. And in some of the dramas this year, we wanted to mention, first off, the wonderful job that was done at Southern Repertory with Veronica in her splendor there in Venus and Fur. I should tell you that that Southern Repertory did a wonderful job on that one.
They also really did. I have to add my kudos to that.
And they not only did a good job here locally, but it was such a good job that they actually got brought up to the Northeast and they presented it in another area. So, you know, not only did New Orleans do well here locally, but they also did well represented up on the Northeast coast. We also had Clyburn Park that was done by Cripple Creek Theater. I wanted to mention them. Monica Harris there, and we also wanted to mention the NOLA Project, who are doing such great work in theater, and their Truckload of Ink, written by Jim Fitzmaurice, a wonderful take on the Times-Picayune, or some people would say, or a newspaper like the Times-Picayune that was going down to a four-day, a week presentation. And then, of course, Southern Rep's presentation of Moises Coffin's 33 Variations, which was absolutely incredible. And of course, I can't go on without mentioning Southern Rep's presentation of Mold, which was John Biganay's outstanding production. Again, there they are, the best dramas in my estimation. Some of you may agree, disagree, but, you know, just a wonderful year for drama. And also wanted to give a shout out across the table here to Mark Cortale Productions for the incredible job. I mean, you know, you mentioned Megan Hilty. We had Megan Mullally as well, but also we had pictures that we're going to show now of Jane Krakowski from
30 Rock.
You know, from 30 Rock that people may remember. She was you know, just too much, just wonderful. We had Patti LuPone twice in 1 year. How can we live with that? Three shows, and she was just, you know, her splendid self. And Sutton Foster again, who's coming back, thank goodness. We'll mention her. And Audra McDonald, my goodness gracious, you know, I just think that was just such an incredible show. And she just did the Sound of Music. Those of you who got a chance
to
see that,
she was
the Mother Abbess, and she was wonderful.
That was a live shot. You took that during the show.
I don't think so.
I'm glad you did.
And speaking of some other shots that I took, these are pictures that I took on the Broadway tour that I conducted myself. Mm-hmm. Maybe one day we'll have a WYS tour, but this is Pippin with Michael James Thomas, who is the star of Pippin. Billy Porter, who got the Tony Award. Wow. There he is from Kinky Boots.
Right.
And then Bertie Carvel, again, from Matilda, who originated the role in the West End and then brought it to Broadway.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much, Alan. And now it is time for our artist spotlight. Tonight, we are featuring Princess and by Robin Durand. Growing up primarily in Hawaii, Durand began selling his art when he was 9 years old. He earned his MFA from LSU and is now a Louisiana resident. His current exhibit, Bling, with artist R.R. Lyon, opens tomorrow night with a reception from 6 to 10 p.m. at Graphite Galleries on Royal Street and will be on view through January 11th. Visit graphitenola.com for more information. That's Princess 2. Just a reminder that you can check out Steppin Out's online calendar at WYES.org, where you can find information about WYES's Downton Abbey Gala coming up in January. That's January 24th. New Orleans Magazine's Quiz Queen Julia Street has a question for us. Last time we wanted the English and French names for the French confection that is shaped like a log, a U-log, or Bouche de Noël. Now tonight's question. There are four streetcar lines in New Orleans, three with red streetcars. Name two of the red lines. Email your answers to steppinout@wyes.org. Our prizes, a Louisiana Life magazine subscription, a gift certificate for Vianne's Tea House, offering their culinary and gourmet tea experience for two. Tonight we have some clever kitchen tiles, animal-themed. It's Schnauzer or Never, okay, Cat-a-tonic, Cafe Olé, and Girls Gone Chihuahua. Woo! And check out our friends at wearablevegetables.com for those. And we also have the new Betty Grunch and the Bunch CD. And we have the Cajun Night Before Christmas ornament book, Christmas in New Orleans by John McGill and me, and Louisiana Eats by Poppy Tooker, all published by Pelican. Thank you, Pelican. And now our picks. Ian.
We talked about beignets earlier. Well, how about pralines? Those are seeing a bit of a comeback, too. Aunt Sally's just opened a new headquarters on St. Charles Avenue in the Warehouse District, and they're doing a praline tour and a praline tasting at their praline tasting bar. Pretty fun experience.
A really good idea.
Yeah.
Yes, Mr. Keith.
Other than a chocolate beignet, which sounds awesome.
yes, it really does.
New Year's Eve coming up. Go see the Revivalists at the Civic Theater downtown. They just got signed a national record deal. Wind Up Records, band from here. They're going to be a big deal.
Okay, and how about your book? Is it still available?
Oh, yes, it's still available.
Okay, let's show
interrupted.
It. Plug.
Yeah, plug.
Groove
Interrupted.
Plugs.
Lost Renewal in the Music of New Orleans. You can get it at all the major bookstores.
Okay, good.
Yes, indeed.
Alan.
Just want to remind everybody, there's still some seating left for the New Year's Swingin' Eve at the National World War II Museum. Dinner from 9 to 11, and then Jump, Jive, and Wail at 9 p.m. The Victory Bells come on at 10, and finally, Jay Hagan and the Victory Big Band will bring you into the new year right.
Okay, and Mark, once again, Golden Girls?
Golden Girls, Mid-City Theater. You can go on their website, midcitytheater.com, and it's running through January 12th. And of course, don't miss Alice Ripley and Sutton Foster.
Yes, you know, and Mid-City Theater, if folks have never been to that theater, that is the most comfortable theater and well-located, too.
It's great.
Right behind American Can, too.
I love it. Sue Gonzi's amazing. She runs it.
And my picks, the Crescent City Countdown with live music starting at 9 p.m. and culminating in the fleur-de-lis drop and fireworks display on the river. And that will take place New Year's Eve, of course, at Jackson Square and Decatur Street. Visit Crescent City criticcountdown.com for more information. And looking ahead, don't miss the Funny 40 Fellows PPP streetcar ride. That's Monday, January 6th. To kick off the carnival season, you can visit the funny40fellows.com website to see the route and learn a lot more. Thank you all very much. It's great to see you. And welcome.
Have a good 2014.
Happy New Year. Good night.